questo nostro incontro. E anche oggi l'appuntamento incontri Pauline è ricco di esperienza.
Our session will be very rich in experience, but
così è già i volti si vedono mentre
You'll see the faces in a few minutes. We'll also have Father Domenico joining us. Oh, here he is. Welcome also to Father Domenico. And so we are live. And in the meantime, we want to greet this pious disciples from the Divine Master House of Prayer in Camaldoli. The Annunziatine,
insieme a Marcello Hector,
and also he's greeting the other people who are tuning in live.
Diremo questi incontri, come sempre, sono,
and we'll say this, these encounters, as always, are international, where
non solo la famiglia Paolina, ma
it's not
amici,
just the Pauline family, but also our friends. Friends of the Pauline family who are coming, joining from all around the world to participate in this program, which has as its theme important themes in our life and spirituality, themes not just important for the Pauline family, but for the church, themes of communication. We can call this like a box to bring out important aspects of our life in a 360 degree kind of view. I think that we can begin this session, which is dedicated this time to a beautiful, important, meaningful person who is not always known, and his name is Father Bernardo Antonini. Father Bernardo Antonini was a priest from the Diocese of Verona.
Amante della parola di Dio,
is a great lover of the Word of God. He was a teacher for many years and dedicated his life for many years to teaching. But he was also a great missionary, to the point that, as we find written in our theme, I love Russia. He's a missionary to Russia. A man, a priest who really had as the world as his horizon, and specifically Russia, this land rich in faith, tradition, culture, also suffering, as we will certainly hear from our guests. So, Father Bernardo was born just yesterday, that is, in October 20, 1932, in a tiny town in the Trent province, which is in the Diocese of Verona. And within his life, up until the 26th of March 2002, when he died unexpectedly in Kazakhstan, within this arc of his life, he lived really strong and demanding experiences. And to speak of Father Bernardo, we have with us today four witnesses, and it's hard to describe them completely. I'll leave it to them to present themselves, but simply I'll greet them and present them. First, Father Giuseppe, welcome. He's a priest from Verona and the postulator for the diocesan phase for Father Bernardo's cause for this canonical process for canonization. With him, Father Luca. He is also a priest from the Diocese of Verona. And he's been ordained just under 4 months. He's living right now and studying in Rome to study canon law. And Father Luca has something to say to us about Father Bernardo. And we certainly will listen to him most gladly. Then we also have Father Domenico, who's a Pauline, who has for many years
ha
the assistant and the person who was responsible for the Institute of Jesus Priest. So he knew Father Bernardo personally. And so Father Domenico, who's from Bari, lives in the community of Bari, and he has something to say to us how he met Father Bernardo and the wealth of his Pauline life. And finally, but last but not last, farthest away, but still closest, Father Sergei. Father Sergei is a Catholic priest he's Russian. He lives in a town called Tula, 200 kilometers from Moscow. He knew Father Bernardo's for the Bernard since he was young and from the beginning of his time discerning a priestly vocation. So his presence and witness is very meaningful because he will tell us about Father Bernard as someone who lived within the cultural and religious reality of Russia and specifically of Moscow. So welcome to everyone. Thank you for your presence and your witness. Before to hand the mic over to Father Giuseppe, I want to show you a little video that sums up, not the life, but some images of Father Bernardo. Also, to be able to see and hear, see his face, hear his words, some beautiful images that will help us to understand, for those who don't know him, many of us never met him, who is Father Bernardo.
Grande dono e forza per la loro vocazione, ma anche con gioia.
E caro mio, qua bisogna mettersi in tenuta sportiva. In tenuta sportiva, eccola.
Quella di Don Bernardo fu una vita spesa per la diocesi di Verona. Svolse numerosi incarichi per diffondere entusiasticamente, anche attraverso i nuovi mezzi di comunicazione, quella fede che viveva con grande freschezza ed entusiasmo. Aderì anche alla famiglia Paolina entrando nell'istituto Gesù Sacerdote. Particolare la collaborazione di Don Bernardo con Telepace, molto seguiti i corsi biblici che proponeva ogni anno. Questa collaborazione proseguì anche quando il sacerdote intraprese quella che vogliamo definire una vera e propria avventura della fede, totalmente abbandonato alla volontà della provvidenza. Nel novembre di quell'anno Don Bernardo si reca a Mosca. Ha 57 anni e porta con sé una fede incrollabile e un grande desiderio di conoscere la cultura russa e la sua profonda spiritualità, che non si era mai estinta.
Popolo russo, il tipo russo è un tipo meditativo e direi naturalmente religioso. Il comunismo, togliendo la religione, ha fatto un errore psicologico e culturale enorme. Il russo, così anche per la vastità, con questi orizzonti che non finiscono mai, insomma, ha quasi il senso innato dell'infinito. E la religione, la letteratura del secolo scorso è un capolavoro di religione, insomma, anche se non cattolico, è secondario, ma di religione. Quindi, questa richiesta, fortissima richiesta del religioso, ha radici profonde nella cultura e nel temperamento. Poi c'è una ragione contingente, i 70 e più anni di blocco religioso, quindi adesso per reazione c'è un desiderio, ma dappertutto io posso parlare di religione. Tanto io vesto sempre così, in modo che tutti mi vedono, ma io ho avuto la più piccola, non so, neanche, avrei quasi più vergogna, non ce l'ho, ma avrei quasi più vergogna in Italia che non a Mosca, insomma.
Posiziono nelle mani dei presbiteri, il rettore del seminario è il primo, si prepara
per pregate perché ottobre, la prima domenica di ottobre, la festa del Rosario, ci sia tra i molti miracoli che io vedo, occhio, siamo anche comunque. Sarà un miracolo, perché adesso quando salirò lunedì e tornerò a Mosca, e solo presentarsi al Ministero delle Comunicazioni Sociali a chiedere i dovuti permessi, ci vuole il miracolo che il ministro firmi, o il direttore mi firmi il decreto di approvazione, come l'ho firmato per la scuola di teologia, come l'ho firmato per la radio, ma è sempre un po' un'impresa.
Sto vivendo una delle più belle giornate di questi 12 anni. Non so se dire la più bella, ma oggi è certamente la più bella.
Lucia, Santa Lucia, venia la gente, perché cambia. Santa Lucia, Santa Lucia.
Ecco delle belle immagini, anche simpatiche, della persona, dell'uomo.
They are the beautiful images, charming.
Di un sacerdote veronese,
the person, the man, the priest, the missionary.
E allora, Don Giuseppe, darei subito la parola
a Veronese priest who loved Russia deeply. So, Father Giuseppe, I'm going to give this, ask you right away. Tell us who Father Bernardo was. Father Bernardo is born in the Diocese of Trent. Until he was 4 years old, he lived in Cinigo. Then at age four, they came to Verona. And then a few kilometers from there, he went to elementary school. At 11, he went to the seminary, the junior seminary where he was, followed the whole seminary program, and was ordained in 1955 by the then bishop. And what's interesting is about this man, from the time he was little, about 8 years old, he began to pray for Russia, because the Paulines, when they went by with the books on propaganda, they had spoken about Our Lady of Fatima, and the mother bought an image of Our Lady of Fatima, and he had it in his room, and every evening he prayed for the conversion of Russia. So his vocation to Russia was born when he was still a little boy. As a young priest, he was sent to a parish on the outskirts of Verona for a year. Then the bishop sent him to the minor seminary in Rovere to teach literature. At the same time, he enrolled him at the Catholic University of Milan to get a degree in languages. Then sent him for a licentiate in theology. Sent him back to teach first in high school, then in the theologate. But his life was full of surprises, because he really had this desire to study the Bible. And the bishop first, it seemed to have a bit of trouble with him, and then called him in the middle of the day and said, "Okay, Bernardo, go to Rome and study the Bible." So he sent him to the Biblical Institute. He got his magna cum laude license in the biblical studies, went back to study, went back to teach biblical studies, and then became director. And that's how I came to know him in 1951. And then I knew him even after his death, because when he came, his body came, it was received in my town. But wherever he went, he created enthusiasm. The film shows that. Wherever he went, people were enthusiastic. I don't know how many parishes he went through in Verona to start up or institute Bible groups, biblical days. He created enthusiasm everywhere. That was his gift. Some people judged him as superficial, but instead, he was constantly announcing the Word of God with joy in his heart. Certainly, at a certain point, he felt this need to go to Russia, and when there was the millennium of the Church of Russia, and he just could, a bishop couldn't put him off any longer. He sent him to study the language. He went to study Moscow to study the language for 2 summers, and that was a beautiful experience too. He stayed at the university, naturally celebrated the mass in his room at the window, looking out at Moscow, looking at the lights of the night. At a certain point, he asked to be able to celebrate mass publicly, and he went to the TV station, where there was also, naturally, the pictures of the great men of Russia. And he said, Catholics, Orthodox, Muslims, atheists, they were all there for mass, and he celebrated the mass. The Catholics asked, and he said, do you want us to take those pictures down? And he said, no, they need the mercy of God too. How can you forget a man like that? To tell you the truth, every once in a while, when he was in Russia, he would call me for the case of a priest to get him to the hospital. Get him admitted to the hospital because they couldn't go, so I would take care of that as a pastoral help, so then afterward they could go to. What's really beautiful is till the very end of his life, he did this service for all the priests in the area. I want to tell you another thing, if I can. About his death, because that evening, on March 26th, they celebrated the Chrism Mass. All the priests of the Diocese of Karaganda, it was Tuesday, and some of them had traveled, you know, hundreds or thousands of kilometers, and had supper together, but he didn't eat, he didn't feel good, but he greeted them one by one, all the priests. He had somebody accompany him home, but he walked 100 or 200 meters, and he asked to go to confession. He went to confession. He also asked Father Athanasius for something, and the father said, oh, maybe tomorrow. And he said, well, maybe tomorrow there won't be a need for it. And in fact, during the night, he went to heaven. So what's extraordinary here also is the next morning, the seminarians didn't see him in church. They heard the TV going in his room, and they thought something important must be going on, because that's not normal. So someone went in and they found him sitting in his chair. The bed was not used, and he was in his chair, dead in his chair. But what has really struck me was he was there with a smile on his face. And I have here his rosary, the rosary beads that were right there on the bedside table. He had a smile. And for me, it's extraordinary, because if you think from Wednesday to Saturday, there's not a lot of time. They had this service Thursday, and then on Holy Saturday, his body was already in my parish with an open casket, and the people were coming and visiting for two days straight. And then we had the funeral in the cathedral. He drew people to him while he was living and while he was dead. It was the same thing. I look today, if you let me imagine, where is this coming from? I'm getting requests for his picture, the prayer, and a relic from the Philippines, from Canada, from Brazil. How can you say that this isn't something beautiful?
Certainly,
His life was beautiful. It was and rich. His priestly missionary life. Do you remember something, given that you had the possibility to study and deepen all these things? How did he get to Moscow? Was there some significant experience? How did he get to Kazakhstan? Because to keep, it's not something automatic to pick up and move. I have to say, at Verona, everybody was against it. Everybody said it was like a lightning bolt. They don't know that it starts from when he was 8 years old. First, he insisted with the bishop to learn the language. He brought a book to learn the language at home with the permission of Father Lamera. We have the letter here from Father Lamera. I bought the computer with the permission of Father Lamera. The first letter he wrote with the computer was written to the Blessed Mother, thanking her. But in his heart, there was this love for Russia, this need to go. But he didn't know anything. And so for 2 years, he went during the summer to learn the language. Then it happened that the bishop gave him the permission. He wrote, the bishop wrote that there was a priest available, and then he went. They sent him for a couple of months far from Moscow, where there were lots of Germans. Since he also knew German, because he knew Russian, English, German, Spanish. And so he went there. At a certain point, instead, they needed him in Moscow, because it was a course for lay people, an institute for lay people, and they needed someone, a teacher. And so he went there, returned to Moscow. In the meantime, he went to Verona for the summer, returned to Moscow, and went to this institute. And there were all kinds of people, Catholics, non-Catholics, Orthodox, but they needed to hear the word of God. I'm going to tell you another thing, if I have time. In the taxi, when he went in the taxi, he would talk about God. He talked about God everywhere. And the taxi driver, at a certain point, they were arriving at the destination, and he stopped. And he said, "Please don't stop. I've never heard anybody talk to me about God. Keep talking." He was in love with God, in love with the Word. He could not talk about God. And this struck people. It made an impression on people. There's, maybe 80, so many episodes that I could just keep going. Maybe later.
No, prego, prego.
Volevo accennare al discorso che è stato all'Istituto dei Laici, ma a un certo punto.
I want to highlight regarding that institute, inside of him there was this pressure to have a seminary, to refound the seminary. The bishop told him, "If you find me this many seminarians, we'll reopen it." I don't know if it was by 1993. The bishop announced on Holy Thursday, "We're going to open a seminary," and then they started the experience with the seminary. But he went to Lourdes every year, and he went to the Blessed Mother to say, "I need this many vocations, because the bishop won't give me a seminary unless we have this many." And he really trusted the Blessed Mother.
So these
were his points of contact with the Blessed Mother. Thank you so much, Father Giuseppe, for this first description, this first sketch of the figure of Father Bernardo. In the meantime, we want to also greet everyone who is following us, and he's listing the people who are live watching.
Tarroni, così come Rosetta, lo piccolo. Ecco, molti si stanno collegando e sono, come dire, in diretta con noi per ascoltare, conoscere la figura appunto di Don Bernardo. E ricordo che
A lot of people are following us live to know Father Bernardo. I remember that within this set of meetings, if anybody wants to ask a question, it's welcome. It will help us to understand and deepen our understanding of this witness and servant of God. I was thinking to show two other pictures, two images that clearly concern Father Bernardo, but here, Father Bernardo in relationship to the Pauline family. So to move then to Father Domenico, to tell us how Father Bernardo came to know the Pauline family. So here's the first picture. He's here with Father Stefano Lamero and another priest,
al nostro fondatore,
John Righetti, and here Alberione. He is Father Bernardo is visiting
Beato,
Father
una foto che è stata
Alberione's
a Roma, nel
tomb when he was servant of God.
Guarda caso, il nome
this was taken
Don Bernardo
in Rome
poi, ha trovato,
at the
ha dato,
Queen of Apostles Sanctuary,
al
so
seminario, appunto,
not by chance.
Don Domenico, come hai conosciuto,
this picture was found in the diocese. This picture was found in the diocesan seminary of Moscow.
E il suo
Father
con la famiglia
Domenico,
Roma,
how did you meet Father Bernardo?
Vedi, più che dire come
was his meeting, and how did he come to meet the Pauline family?
Dire,
now, more than say how I came to know him, I think it's important to say, why did he enter the Pauline family? Because there are motivations that it's necessary to understand. Father Bernardo was not the only priest of the Institute in that diocese. I remember Father Giuseppe Gregoris, who's probably older, Father Antonio, we saw in that photo, the Lord called to himself, his sister still alive, Father Angelo. So there's more than one priest from the Diocese of Verona. Usually when a diocesan priest enters into a movement, it means that he's going to look for something he doesn't find in the diocese, that he doesn't find among his fellow priests. And he says, oh, look, now here I find myself. I find it really good here. You could say that about movements. But for Father Bernardo, he was a diocesan priest of Verona. The bishop and his diocese and his diocesan brothers were everything for him. He wasn't looking for something else. For he wasn't looking for another spirituality because something was missing in the diocese. If it was that way, it would have been a gap. Instead, for Father Bernardo, he always loved the Diocese of Verona. And also, even if some of the priests, though they were a minority, didn't understand his apostolate or his zeal, because he made people pretty tired, he still loved the priests. This love towards the priesthood, he acquired that in the seminary. And then Father, he consumed himself for the priesthood. And he never spoke ill of his fellow priests. Isn't that the case, Father Giuseppe? So, before this figure to say, why did Father Bernardo enter the Institute? The motivation is owing to a conception of consecrated life. When we look at Father Bernardo, look at how he sees the consecrated life. Consecrated life isn't for the priesthood, it's for the laity. St. Augustine, before being a priest or a bishop, was a monk. St. Basil was a monk. St. John Chrysostom was a monk. The monk with someone who wanted his baptism to be completely of the Holy Trinity. So this gift that of itself belongs to the baptized can also be given to a priest. And we have the conception, a mistaken conception, a little Manzonian from the book The Betrothed. There, the religious or consecrated person is Father Chrysostom. And we have this, he's speaking of two characters in the book. People enter the religious life to be priests. He said, no, in the history of the Church and in the Vatican II document on religious life, consecration is to the Blessed Trinity. One of the motives is for a more intimate consecration to the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And given that this can be to any of the baptized, because also a sister, the sisters are lay people, they're not in the hierarchy, they're not ordained. Why could it not also be for a priest? So this intimate bond with the desire to give everything to the Trinity. There's also the possibility after the document Pro Vita Mater that diocesan priests who are not religious could offer themselves publicly to this total gift, which is more baptismal than priestly. And for Father Bernardo, seeing this, there's another motive, which is pastoral charity would be increased and not diminished. So as a diocesan priest, he was a pastor of souls. The consecration, this gift of pastoral charity would be increased. This would be the motivations that would have moved him to enter the Institute. And they're written here in a booklet that I have. Then there's the motive, why did he choose the Pauline family? He knew the Pauline family through the Daughters of St. Paul. He used to visit the book center, and the Daughters of St. Paul asked him to be their chaplain. What struck Father Bernardo, and it wasn't really the devotion of St. Paul, but the centrality of Jesus' way, truth, and life. When he celebrated the Holy Mass, of which Father Giuseppe spoke at the University of Moscow, seeing at his right in front of his face the three images of Marx, Engels, and Lenin, he said, these are three charlatans of humanity. I have come to announce to you Christ, way, truth, and life. Next Sunday will be the feast of Jesus Master, way, truth, and life. And we have to understand that for Father Bernard, this spirituality was something he lived. But why? Because we're amazed before the question that Jesus says, you know, who do the people say that I am? And people say, and then Christ, and then Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. But what's the definition Christ gives of himself? I'm the light of the world. I'm the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. But the highest definition the exegetes tell us is when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. One could say, here in front of a mountain so high, you can't see the top. And this centrality of Christ, way, truth, and life conquered Father Bernardo. When he came to know the Pauline spirituality, it wasn't sentimentality, it wasn't a movement, but it centers everything in Jesus' truth, way, and life. And he came to know, he knew the scriptures so well, he knew this much more. Then there's another, why St. Paul? the motivation by which he would choose St. Paul and the Pauline charism is this something he wrote, the spiritual Holy Spirit and church dimension of the spirituality. So the Holy Spirit, the way in which St. Paul presents the Holy Spirit in all his letters, conquered Father Bernardo, and also the zeal of St. Paul. So there were many motives. So the before the Trinity, he chose this consecration with the holy vows, then individually the Pauline family because of its strong spirituality, which many Paulines still don't really know, and he understood it. And then the pneumatological, the way in which St. Paul presents the Holy Spirit as guiding the church. So these are the motives that I saw in Father Bernardo and that led him to choose the Institute of Jesus the Priest, but not because he wanted to run away from Verona, which he always loved. Following on that, Father, there's a beautiful story, a witness from the Bishop of Verona in this little book, The World is My Parish. It has some of the thoughts of Father Bernardo. And the bishop says, Father Bernardo had a heart full of God in Christ Jesus. Nobody could take it out of him. He would have preferred martyrdom. He felt the need to communicate it to others, the one who filled his life with meaning. In him, he felt in miniature the fervor of Paul when to the Corinthians he witnessed and announced the gospel full of vitality. Woe to me if I do not announce the gospel. With these words, with this little witness, we see Father Bernardo full of God and full of Paul. And so we understand also his missionary spirit and his dynamism, his apostolic priestly dynamism, and in that Russian context. And not just Russian, in all of his experience as a priest in Verona. And precisely because of this, I think that the person and the witness who can speak to us best about this, of Father Bernardo in Russia, in Russia is precisely Father Sergi, and we thank him for his presence. Father Sergei, before giving you the microphone, we're going to look at a few pictures of Father Bernardo in Moscow, or I'm not really sure where he is, but you'll be able to tell us where he is, because you know the geography in his different places. Here he is.
Forse a Chivo, se non mi sbaglio, durante la visita del Papa Giovanni Paolo II, Don Bernardo accompagnava il gruppo dei laici.
If not mistaken, that was during the visit of Pope John Paul II. He accompanied the group of the lay people to Kiev.
Qui sta arrivando a Mosca qui.
As they're arriving in Rome, St. Peter's Square, at an audience, the general audience, with the bishop. This is in front of the seminary, the Orthodox seminary, and the Orthodox Theological Seminary. With this is they made a visit. The seminarians made a visit there. In the Orthodox Church. I don't know which one.
In Siberia, durante l'inverno russo.
Maybe in Siberia during the Russian winter. This is one of the parishes, the Russian parishes. I don't see too clearly. We have several of these little chapels, little churches of wood. They're all the same in different parishes in Russia. I think this is in Siberia, around 2000.
Don Sergei, come hai conosciuto Don Bernardo? E insomma, che cosa
a few photos that we were able to find. Father Sergi, how did you meet Father Bernardo? And what did his presence do for you? I met him in my parish in Moscow, where I began going almost every day. And Father Bernardo, at that time, when he came to that institute for the laity, then, and right away, he began that work of looking for vocations, but obviously he looked first through prayer. So he started to offer the Mass every first Thursday of the month, a Mass for vocations. And so I would go to those Masses. I saw him there. I saw him as a priest who I didn't know yet, but who certainly loved the liturgy, who sought to involve everybody in the liturgy, tried to explain these things. And then the first direct meeting that he had, I had decided that I had to give it a try to enter the seminary. And he, seeing me, how old I was, he invited me to join his institute for the laity, and I said, "No, Father Bernardo, thank you, but I'm going to go to the seminary right away." And he said, "Oh, great." That was my first real encounter. But the thing that struck above all is that he was an authentic priest. As Father Domenico said, he really lived all his spirituality, and you could see that spirituality, that love for the church, love for the liturgy, love for the Eucharist, and love for Christ and his word. So love to diffuse that will always to diffuse the word of God. And then with him, I lived 6 years in the seminary, because practically Father Bernardo at that time, the diocese only had 30 priests. So when they were thinking about organizing the theological studies, he had to be the rector, because there was no seminary. They had to found a seminary to try to adapt everything he knew about a seminary to the concrete situation of Russia, not to simply bring things in from Verona, but work with what they had. And 6 years with Father Bernardo as rector, and that relationship that he had with God, with Our Lady, his way of saying, I'm going to call Our Lady on the telephone to ask something with the rosary. I'm going to go call her up. That priestly zeal, the pastoral zeal for the seminarians, but everybody all the way to St. Petersburg knew this. One time, he was still rector, he was still teaching at the lay institute, And he was also teaching in St. Petersburg. So every Thursday evening, he took the train at night to go to Moscow. He spent the whole day at the Lay People's Institute with Mass and spiritual encounters, teaching. He returned Sunday morning early. Obviously, he took a taxi. One time it happened to me to take a taxi from the station to go to the seminary, and the driver bringing me there, he said, but years ago I always brought this old priest, very interesting, he always talked to me about the Bible. And it's like, oh, I found that famous taxi driver that I knew about from my days as a seminary. It was sort of an inheritance that we have to discover this taxi driver. So this love that he had for the church, his obedience that he taught to us with his own life. And it's this that was very important to me as an example, a living example that you don't read in the books. When you can only get this by living. First, we heard also from your witness examples his passion, his apostolic passion as an evangelizer in the style of St. Paul. And if I understood well, he also started a couple of magazines. He used the television, he used the radio, or started a radio program. Can you tell us something about this aspect of Father Bernardo? Well, he always said to use the media, the modern media of communication, and that was part of his vocation as a Pauline. To us, he said it. So he founded a newspaper, a weekly, that went ahead for many years. And then he founded also a radio program, Radio Mary, a daily show, The Light of the Gospel, and he united this conviction to reach all of Russia, the Catholic Church in Russia. Russia is huge, the church is small, and really needs to know how to communicate itself. I would say that newspaper created the first connections of the sense of being one church. And then with his apostolic zeal, I would say that for me, what really struck me a lot, that was in the year 2000, the year Great Jubilee, when he was named by the bishops as head of the commission, but really he was the only one responsible for all of Russia. And he tried to create the Jubilee, not that it would just be a couple of pilgrimages to the Rome or the Holy Land, but to bring the Jubilee to every parish, to create a Jubilee day. And he prepared a beautiful talk, really about a half an hour, 40 minutes, on the most important points of the Jubilee. And really, literally, he went to all the parishes of Russia. I saw him 3 or 4 times. It happened that we were together at that time. I, as a young priest, maybe a couple of others. For me, it was fine. It was a talk. It was really good. You know, he prepared us in the seminary, and we knew it went. It was going fine. But some years later, after John Bernardo died, after the Jubilee, it happened that I went to one of these parishes, and they told me, "Oh yes, I really remember Father Bernardo. He gave a talk about the Jubilee, and I still remember he told us these 3 points." And then they tell me the points that Father Bernardo gave. They saw Father Bernardo one time in their life. They were so struck by the fact that he came at that parish far away, very small. Then they were so struck that they still remembered the meaning of the Jubilee. As a celebration of Christ and the salvific will of God. In the meantime, we also want to show some of the feedback that we've been receiving from our friends at home. It's always been a joy to follow the Pauline encounters. I'm grateful to the Lord to be part of the Pauline family as a cooperator of the Pauline family.
Successore nella parrocchia di San Michele, Giovanni, penso Don Giovanni.
I was his successor in the parish of St. Michael when he taught in the middle of the seminary. I was the assistant of the students. Thanks for this transmission, Father Giovanni Castiglione.
Testimone missionario che conosciamo poco poi in realtà. Sento che illumina oggi il cammino e la missione Paolina.
Don Bernardo, a most beautiful missionary witness whom we know very little. I feel that he can enlighten today the journey and mission of the Paulines. This is partly Spanish, so I can't really understand very well. Thank you for the witness. I pray for you, Sister Emanuela. From Albano.
Don Sergei o Don Giuseppe potete rispondere. Dice così.
A question from Father Roberto about maybe Father Sergei or Father Giuseppe could respond to it. The ecumenism, which Father Alberione also had very much at heart, has changed has it changed in its theological structure along the years in the cultural relationship with the Orthodox? How did Father Bernardo, Monsignor Antonini, bring this forward with the Orthodox Church? Well, we saw also in the photos before in front of the Orthodox Seminary, Father Bernardo came to Russia first of all with the feeling that he was there to help the Orthodox Church. That is, to help with the mission of proclaiming the gospel, to help with his ability with what he knew. And he started with that. Then, when he got there, he found the needs of the little Catholic Church, who really had needs. It had people who needed priests and formation for the laity. But it's to seek to help, to give a hand, whether in seminary there was always there were always Orthodox teachers too in the seminary, even bishops as professors in the Catholic seminary. The subject matter, the text, the history of the Orthodox Church, the Orthodox theology, we were never taught in terms of a fight or a struggle, but it was the Orthodox themselves who taught us these things. Then Even now, the library of the seminary, Father Bernardo was very educated, and he really tried to fill the library to perform a service. And now the seminary library is named the Father Bernardo Antonini Library. It's visited by the Orthodox academics, and every year some of them write their thesis on the Catholic history or theology. So they borrowed the material from that library. So there's a very concrete ecumenism of service. And it's concrete in the sense of creating friendships, knowledge, reciprocal knowledge. Father Giuseppe, do you have anything to add from this point of view on this dialogue with the church? I would only add this particular. He liked preaching, teaching in the seminary. When he came to Italy, when he got financial help from Italy, he did this. He gave part to the Catholics and part to the Orthodox. He never kept it for himself. He had a big heart for the Orthodox. So when he had his anniversary, the archpriest of the Orthodox Church gave a beautiful testimony. He said Don Bernardo was one who loved the Orthodox and continued among them, maintained stable friendships with them, and was there to help them to grow in good. And one more point, little detail on what Father Domenico said. All the homilies of Father Bernardo always had kind of a beginning seal. He would begin, "Come Holy Spirit through Mary." And at the end, the closure would be, "All to the greater glory of God and of Mary." They all had that kind of, now the homily's complete, because here were the two markers at the beginning and the end.
Don Sergei prima parlava.
I have it all here, so I. The Paulines. You also have a great deal of this. Father Sergei first spoke about the library and highlighted that the students who want to make their do their thesis go to that library, and it's named after Father Bernardo. Regarding these theses, Father Luca can tell us a little something in the sense that we'd like to hear how you came to come to know Father Bernardo, but then tell us a little bit of the fruit of this journey of getting to know him and your work, the thesis that has become a book on Father Bernardo. First of all, it's a duty that I have to give up. First of all, to say that I didn't know Father Bernardo personally. This could seem strange, but during a long experience of the school year in Russia, in the city of the most western city in Russia, it's right on the Polish-Lithuanian border, I came to know the Catholic situation. And among there are some Russian priests and some Belarusian who knew Father Bernardo, who had been taught by him. And among them, you know, we have like Father Sergei. At the end of this experience in 2009, in my own city, in Verona, I met Father Giuseppe, and as soon as he realized that I could speak Russian, he got me involved in this cause of beatification of Father Bernardo to help translate different documents and material that were in Russian. This experience helps me to deepen my knowledge, and I can say my friendship, my spiritual friendship with this servant of God, Father Bernardo. I knew him in Russia through his fruits, the fruits of his ministry, the Russian priests, But then I knew him through his writings and the witnesses of the testimonies of these people who collaborated, lived with him, met him in Russia and in Kazakhstan. And all of this came at a very particular moment in my life when the vocational question was coming to me, Lord, what do you want me to do with my life? And Father Bernardo, this image had put into my heart this difficulty with his life, his experience, told to me by so many people. He seemed to be telling me there's really many needs in the church, and especially in Russia and Kazakhstan. The life of Father Bernardo was spent in those lands. It kind of provoked me. What could I do with my life? What can I put at the service of God in the church? The knowledge that I was gaining, especially a study of the language and the experience that was little by little increasing. But above all, in that land, I felt welcomed, loved, guarded, I could say, throughout this experience of study by the priests who had been formed by Father Bernardo, by the communities that he had visited, that he had evangelized, that he had helped grow, not only in the particular Russian cities, but also in Moscow and in Kazakhstan, and he's naming the cities. And I had this by chance, as it were, not intentionally, but I had followed his own footsteps geographically in Russia. And through these priests, these people that the Lord caused me to meet, I felt the Lord's love for me, a love that I deserved a full response. And now, as a young priest, just less than 4 months, committed now with the ministry of study of canon law in Rome, the person of Father Bernardo challenges me in a new way, still in, more as insistent as before, but not as a model to imitate, but as a guardian, a friend, a companion in the environment of the priestly life for which Father Bernardo, as Father Sergei said, that you have the sacraments, celebration of the Eucharist, sacrament of reconciliation. I want to do this with the same profound attitude that Father Bernardo had, deep and at the same time simple. Then continuing to study and deepen the Word of God, we know how much commitment Father Bernardo gave to announcing the Word of God, this love and commitment of his. So when I'm called to share in the homily with the brothers and sisters this word of God, guarding then this filial attitude toward the Mother of God, and then accompanied by Father Bernardo in living obedience, the promise I made in my diaconal and then presbyteral ordination, I'm making my first steps here in Rome by studying. Father Bernardo was a giant of obedience, that he lived decisively in a heroic way, and I pray to him to sustain me to live it daily in my study today and then tomorrow in whatever service will be asked of me. What is really meaningful today for the church, not just Russia, but universal, a bit the this little book, a little something about the book, The Catholic Church in Russia, The Service of Father Bernardo. That's something that we just published through this other publisher in June. It's very simple. It's my bachelor's degree thesis. I think today we can reread the person of Father Bernardo and appreciate him even more, discover some new, the churchliness of this man. Those who lived with him in Russia and Kazakhstan They have no doubts on his love of God and his love for the church, the universal church, and the importance he also gave to ecumenical dialogue with the Orthodox Church in Russia. In my turn, reading this from these years of difference, I've discovered, and I've tried to describe in my book, a real clinging of Father to the church in his time, the church led at that time by Pope Saint John Paul II. But what's interesting to note, and I'll speak in the conclusion, how surprising it was to me how much his message, that of Father Bernardo, matches the modern, like today's pathway, the ecumenical path of Pope Francis, this slogan of that we Christians and all the churches are called to journey, pray, and work together among ourselves. So this praying, working, walking together, I think of the apostolate of Father Bernardo, as I said, this service of evangelization in Russia, the formation of Catholic priests, but also welcoming of priests and sharing among the of charity, innumerable encounters that he had with Orthodox faithful, with other Christian denominations, the love of literature, the letters, the amount of letters that we have from so many people, is a witness to this ecumenical spirit. In 2016, when the Pope and the Patriarch met in Cuba, I think Father Bernardo must have been smiling from heaven. So, if anybody wants to deepen this topic, I've written something about it in my book with the history of the church, the Catholic Church, in a very short, but and the role that I think all that this church 20 years later, the work of the apostolate of Father Bernard, can have in ecumenical dialogue. And it's also a work that has to be updated. Thanks be to God. As of June this year, the October 4th in the cathedral, Father Sergio was there. There's an auxiliary bishop for the Moscow diocese, a Franciscan, a conventual Franciscan friar, who was ordained auxiliary bishop, and he had been received into the seminary by Don Bernardo. He was his first rector, and so Father Sergio was there at the ordination, would remember that. And Father Fra Nicolai continued with the Franciscans, and then he was ordained bishop just over a month ago. I think that this young bishop, this young Russian bishop, is a beautiful sign, an eloquent sign of the evangelizing work of Father Bernardo and how it continues to give fruit today, 20 years after he departed for heaven. Thank you, Father Luke. Father Sergei, do you have anything to point out on this?
No, ancora no.
Sì, ok.
Va bene. Ecco, anzitutto tra quello che ha avuto Don Bernardo come insegnante e rettore ancora in Russia, in realtà Fra Nicolò è stato secondo.
Those who had Father Bernardo as a teacher or rector who are still in Russia, Father Nicolai was already the second bishop. The first bishop, another Franciscan, is in Ukraine. He's an auxiliary bishop in this place in Ukraine, and he came at the end, and he had time to hear Father Bernard as a scripture teacher. But Bishop Nicolai, he himself said that Bernardo had a tremendous influence on his priestly vocation. And so it's clear that that's something ongoing. I'd like to say one more thing. About the church, the Bible school that they call it. It's a collection of lessons on the Bible for the laity, which at that time, now during the pandemic, it's online and on Facebook, but you can see that it's still going on. That was kind of the continuation, his desire to have those lessons and form people to know the sacred scriptures. And from those lay people who remember that passion of Father Bernardo, they created this new initiative, which is completely secular, but it continues to maintain the spirit of Father Bernardo, the enthusiasm, it creates enthusiasm, it creates friendships, and it creates a passion for the sacred scripture. Father Domenico, doesn't it seem to you that listening to the life and works of Father Bernardo, we are listening again to the life and works and passion, the spirituality of Father Alberione, Father Bernardo, already knew the spirituality when he was a chaplain of the Daughters of St. Paul, because the sisters, the daughters at Verona, seeing his love for the Bible and St. Paul, which, you know, preceded his encounter with the Pauline family, because he visited the book center, they asked him to be their chaplain. And he became a friend of the whole Pauline family. The Annunciationists found him more than a father. His secretary, Teresa, you have to remember her in this. Then the Holy Family Institute. Now, the spirituality, he lived it. It's not so much that the press is not like that it's lost its meaning. He never thought that way. We can't think of him like that. Because the mission is that of giving Jesus Christ way, truth, and life. The whole Christ, as he had defined himself. And he learned well from Father Stephen Lamera, to whom Father Alberione entrusted this when he was a deacon. And to Father Lemery, with Father Lemery, it's such a strong relationship. I, myself, reading their letters, I am amazed. It's enough to say that every year, during July, at the end of his teaching in Moscow, he always came to Italy to make his annual retreat with the Institute of Jesus the Priest. At the end of the retreat, he went to preach. This was for the Annunciationists. He followed the Institute of the Holy Family in such a way that they still remember him. I have been amazed by his obedience. And so many other things I could say. We would have many other things to say, but time is flying and we have to go to the conclusion. But let me move to Father Giuseppe for something. What do you want to underscore here? And can you tell us something about the cause for beatification. The first thing I wanted to say is that his slogan to the seminarians in greeting them, the strength of the church, the road of holiness for priests is obedience. So this identifies him as a man of obedience. Now, before I get into his process, we've not been able to... There was something he never could ever do is to go to China. That was another thing he all had in heart, was to go to China. At the beginning of the year, they would do a dedication and a prayer. And his prayer was for the conversion of Russia and China. He had already started to try studying Chinese. He went for a summer in China. He brought a report to the Holy See. We have a report of his trip. His intention was to go there because there was also a need for the gospel. Now, the cause, you know that it was begun in Verona on February 11th, 2009. We have heard 79 witnesses, 77 plus two who were directly to the tribunal, and some other 13 long distance. We've had to go to Kazakhstan, we've had to go to Russia, we had to go to Poland. We even went to the cloistered convent. So you think of these trips that all had to be arranged because we had these witnesses. So these trips you had to arrange. That took a lot of time, but it was a beautiful experience. We closed that in Verona, the October 20th, 2013, the day of his birthday, in the cathedral with various bishops present. Rome gave the recognition that everything was in order on the 14th, or the year 2014, and we have the beginning of the position paper. Now they've entrusted to the theologians who have given their response, and their final response is wonderful. 9 out of 9 gave full approval without any requests or doubts. And it was printed on October 29th last year. We have the responses now. We're waiting the bishops to give their responses, the bishops and the cardinals of the congregation, so that he could be declared venerable. The consultors at the end will give this, will offer their wish that this cause will move forward in an expectation that the Pope will offer his declaration. So this is really beautiful. There's 79 witnesses, of whom 7 bishops, about 30 priests, then sisters and laity, Italians, Kazakhs, and all in that amount of time. Every once in a while, I'm like, How did that other guy's process go so fast? And it was like, well, they were all here in Italy. But with Father Bernardo got it in his head to travel the world. So we had to do the same thing. And with Luca as the translator, we had to follow his footsteps. All these trips with an official translator. We could say, not unfortunately, he traveled the world. No, good thing he traveled the world. Well, we did have to put a bit of effort into it. My goodness. But he was admired everywhere. You have to think, Russia and Kazakhstan are waiting more than we are, his beatification, way more than we Italians are. And so that it's not something, but we haven't spoken much of is his work in Kazakhstan, but that's very impressive. And so we have to close now. A bit of time has passed, but I think that your witness, your testimonies have been beautiful, deep, and they complement each other, because it's about a person that can be known from many points of view. It would be beautiful to speak also about his heritage, what is continuing, but we'll find other opportunities for sure. I'd like to share with some simplicity this last one. It is always good to hear testimonies about Monsignor Bernardo, a priest that I had the grace of having as spiritual director. We can say this last witness from Giuseppe. Certainly, in the name of so many other witnesses, the much good that he did. It's beautiful to see how the life is a seed that was sown in the earth and bears fruit. It bears fruit in the Diocese of Verona. It bears fruit in the Diocese of Moscow, in Kazakhstan, and the Pauline spirit was part of, you know, what spurred this priest on. And he was really a father who gave life to a great deal of apostolic good and helped the people of God to grow. So we close now, as we've done, with a prayer of intercession, prayed also for his process for canonization. And we'll ask Father Giuseppe to pray in the name of all, and we with you will follow this prayer.
Don Bernardo Antonini, un fulgido esempio di sacerdote ardente.
Most Holy Trinity, we thank you for having given us your servant Father Bernardo Antonini, a bright example of an ardent and active priest who used his special gifts to serve the Church in joyful obedience, giving by every means possible the light of the Word and consuming all his energies in the witness of your love for all creation. We ask you to glorify even on earth this faithful minister of yours, and by his intercession grant us the grace that we ask of you. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Queen of the Apostles, grant that we too, on the example of Father Bernardo, your most devoted son, can be always ready and available for the service of God and neighbor. And they're saying the Hail, Holy Queen. And so we'll close together here.
Posso dunque, avvocata nostra, rivolge a noi gli occhi tuoi misericordiosi e mostraci dopo questo esilio Gesù il frutto benedetto del tuo seno. O clemente, o pia, o dolce Vergine Maria.
Domenico, non so se posso dire una cosa.
Questa ultima
Bernardo di Beatrice Immediata si è esaurita ed è anche in lingua spagnola. È un modo di far conoscere meglio Don Bernardo.
Sì, grazie, grazie. Ma appunto avremo altri momenti per approfondire, conoscere l'opera e la vita di Don Bernardo. Allora, grazie a tutti voi che avete partecipato, Don Giuseppe, Don Luca, Don Sergei, Don Domenico. E per noi, per il nostro appuntamento, il nostro prossimo appuntamento di Incontri Paolini è per domenica prossima. È la domenica o giorno della solennità di Gesù Divino Maestro. E E proprio domenica alle 10.30 sarà trasmessa online su Facebook o YouTube la messa, la celebrazione eucaristica, dove il nostro superiore generale Don Valdir José de Castro, superiore generale della Società San Paolo, donerà alla parrocchia di Narzole la reliquia del beato Timoteo Giaccarto. È una promessa che nasce dal nostro compianto superiore generale Don Silvio Sassi, che si concretizza dopo anche un pellegrinaggio della reliquia qui, soprattutto a Roma. Ecco, è un momento bello di famiglia paolina, ma anche di chiesa, con la chiesa e la parrocchia di Narzole, dove un altro testimone, il beato Timoteo Giaccardo, primo sacerdote paolino, ha seguito l'esempio e l'apostolato del beato Giacomo Alberione e appunto con questo dono sarà presente, la sua reliquia sarà presente per sempre appunto nella parrocchia che lo ha conosciuto, che lo ha visto alla luce, che lo ha dato alla luce. Questo è il 25 di ottobre, il 26 di ottobre come sempre il rosario con il beato Giacomo Alberione e il prossimo incontro, il prossimo mercoledì 28 ottobre invece andremo in Polonia, quindi non siamo molto lontani dalla Russia, e per parlare, per conoscere di più la famiglia paolina appunto in Polonia. Grazie a tutti e grazie a voi che avete partecipato.
Grazie.
Ciao, grazie.